And now we have Professor Dr. Neamat Ibrahim. She's going to tell us a lecture on new insights in airway management. Fadal.
The old and the new topic of airway management. This is our home. Perioperative assessment, unfortunately, is a poor taught subject, despite the importance of the management in our daily practice. The topic hardly features few pages in our textbooks. Then the question was asked, why bother? As a serious airway difficulty is very rare in our normal practice, in the so-called normal population. In spite of advances in technology and training, difficult intubation and airway management remain an important cause of perioperative morbidity and mortality in anesthesia. Whatever we debate the merits of the tests used for assessment, when a serious morbidity or mortality is involved, little sympathy will be offered to the practitioner or the anesthetist whose pre-operative airway assessment was at least not sincere. Anesthesiologists who chosen to have their career as anesthesiologists, what they are a group of professionals caring for individuals who happens to be a human being. We render patients unconscious, unable to look after themselves, and with God's help, we take this responsibility ourselves. When, God forbid, things go wrong, mortality and morbidity are little comfort to the relatives who will rescue you, who will sue you medico-legally. On review, the practitioner will be considered as a professional, and his actions will be assessed by his peers and experts in the field, which is not very good. So, simply stated, a few minutes of our time for preoperative history and clinical examination will represent a good medical practice. By practicing and routinely performing an airway assessment, we improve our skills in managing and in assessing whether the airway is easy or difficult. Understanding the patient's airway geometry will enable us to focus on which device or which maneuvers will be suitable for him. Thus, few minutes of history and examination should direct our airway plan and particular choice of equipment making the patient's airway. In the published analysis of records of the UK medical defense, complications arising out of airway management account for 30% of deaths occurring during anesthesia. This is in the UK, which is a huge number. These figures are certainly higher in our developing world. Anesthesia practice itself can lead to preventable harm. Is they preventable? How? What is the example? Persistent attempts at direct laryngoscopy, marra w'tnin w'talata, and the result is delay in employing alternative strategies when intubation is difficult. Then what happens? The senior is called when the injury has happened already, a broken teeth, bleeding, edema, secretions, then he concludes that at least the air management provided by the anesthetist was substandard. Many training programs, unfortunately, do not offer their trainees structured or organized teaching in airway management, and many trainees probably entered practice with limited skills to deal with a difficult airway. We have to admit in our department we have a very competent and sincere team who are persistently training and following the airway management procedures. what is the airway, the mysterious airway assessment? The role of airway assessment is to identify the predicted problems with our main job, maintenance of ventilation and oxygenation. It is the first step in formulating an appropriate airway plan, which should incorporate a staged approach to the unpredicted difficult airway. Airway assessment should be done for all anesthesia encounters. Anyone going to anesthesia should have an airway assessment, whether he's going to have local, no, regional, or maintenance, or general and anesthesia monitored care. Despite the evidence that current airway assessment tools are of low predictive value, this is true. They are all low positive predictive value because low test sensitivity, mild specificity, and above all, the low prevalence of the difficult airway. How many times per day we encounter a difficult airway? Approximately half of all cases of the difficult airway are unrecognized and unpredicted, and this would turn into a life-threatening event. This figure is at least alarming. The difficult airway in the American Society of Anesthesiologists Task Force on the Management of Different Airways states precisely that all anesthesiologists should have a preformed or preconceived strategy for intubation of the difficult airway. In this case, الحقيقة التست اللي بنعملها high sensitivity يعني positive في الديزيز يعني هتقولي ان العيان ده عنده difficult airway او high في specificity يعني هتقولي this airway is clear, it's easy the airway, they do not go together. Thus we tend to have either a test that identifies aggravating number of false positives or that misses difficult or true positive cases. Because the overlap in the features between the easy and difficult intubation, there is no existing test capable of separating absolutely these patients in accuracy. So a gray zone was proposed. Either instead of a cutoff value, we have the gray zone with two cutoff values. The first, exclusion of diagnosis with near certainty. No absolute certainty, but they excluded the diagnosis. This is a clear airway. Or a second cutoff value includes the diagnosis with near certainty, Bardo. So we do not have a precise test. The practitioner, what to do? He have either one of two choices. Either to consider subjecting some of the predicted, but not actually difficult patients to special airway maneuvers, either fiber optic or whatever, but at the opposite is to have some of the predicted easy tense up or turn out to be actually difficult, which will turn into a complication disaster. Which route should we choose? I prefer the first one, more maneuvers, more time, better than shaking in the OR with a difficult airway. Given the low prevalence, وهي دي المشكلة, إن إحنا الإيرواي is very low prevalence. Given the low prevalence of failed intubation and cannot ventilate في general population, so we cannot predict it accurately. But this makes the unexpected difficult airway is a fact of life. هيجي هيجي. So we have to be equipped to deal with it. Thus, it is important to have an airway plan based on history, examination, and special investigations which is available. The plan should be tailored to individual patients and their diagnosis. One does not fit them all, accounting for the skills of the practitioner. Thank you. be sharp-eyed, not so confident of yourself. This is a mistake. And evaluate your abilities very good. ما تعملش السبع رجاله في بعض زي ما بيقولوا عندنا. And then answer these questions which will guide you in putting your plan. Is there a documentation of previous airway difficulty? History guides the future. This is the most important element in assessment. Is there an impact of the surgery on the airway? Is there a difficulty with bag and mask ventilation? Is there a difficulty with supraglottic airway employment? Is there a difficulty in intubating the patient? Is there a difficulty in performing an infraglottic airway in the emergency situation? And whether there is a risk of aspiration, the cardiorespiratory reserve, is it limited or not? Then how the extubation will be easy. Assessment starts with history, as we said. Then is there a gastroesophageal reflux, obstructive sleep apnea. Body mass index is very important. Mouth opening, incisor, inter-incisor gap, modified malampati, teeth examination, and upper lip test or mandible protrusion test, and then thyromental and cervical spine movement. These are the things that we should look for. What is the definition of the difficult airway? Ma fiche precise definition even. عشان in general, airway is subjective. The difficult airway for me is not usually always the difficult airway for someone else. Because in turn, general airway is considered difficult when we cannot oxygenate or ventilate the patients. There is a difficult airway represents a complex interaction between the patients, which is very variable problems, clinical setting where you are working at, and your skills. It is of subjective nature, so the spectrum of definitions used serve to explain the discrepancy in the incidence. The incidence also affected by the regular use now of supraglottic air devices, the use of fiber optic antibiotic, the number of procedures with regional or local anesthesia or monitored anesthesia care, and some reporting bias. So we have defined the airway in its components: difficulty of bag mask ventilation, endotracheal intubation, supraglottic airway device insertion, or subglottic or fiber optic. This is the limited area. Now we come to the incidence. The incidence is very, very low. Mask ventilation, 2%, impossible, 0.15. Difficult laryngoscopy, 1.5 to 8%, and intubation is even lower. The unexpected cannot intubate, cannot ventilate, is 1 every 13,000 to 1 every 25,000. Does it really matter to make an airway assessment? In our career, we will be confronted with one of these situations 2, 3, 5 times at least. And this is a very bad situation. The American Society defined bag mask ventilation inability of unassisted anesthetist to maintain the saturation above 90% with FiO2 of 1. The risks are body mass index more than 30, beard patient. We can shave them. We have a lot of beard patients now, and this is a problem. It's the very bad mask seal. Malampati 3 or 4, age above 57, severely limited jaw protrusion. Difficult laryngeal mask ventilation is the inability to satisfactorily ventilate the patients, which is defined as 7 milliliter per kg, no greater than 15 to 20 centimeter water pressure. Risk factors for LMA failure: advanced age, increased body mass index, male sex, reduced thyromental distance, thick neck, poor dentition, smoking, and surgical blade, surgical table rotation. The incidence, according to the the definition, according to the ASA, who defined difficult intubation as poor proper insertion of the endotracheal tube with conventional laryngoscopy, requires more than 3 attempts or take longer than 10 minutes. 10 minutes, that, يعني بعد خراب ملطة. If you render the patient apneic and keep trying to ventilate him for 10 minutes, you will end up with a brain death. So these 10 minutes should be reconsidered. It's very long duration before calling for help or attempting something else. The Australian critical incident added in limited mouth opening, obesity, limited neck extension, and very important, lack of a trained anesthetist. We have the Cormac and Lehan. You have many, many, many tests, Cormac and Lehan laryngeal view, which is considered difficult when the vocal cords cannot be seen. Malympathy classification, according to the structure, the oropharynx, the malympathy is last century, divided patient into three categories, and then Samoon tried a fourth category, and they said that it's in good correlation with Cormac and Lehan, which is a gold standard. The thyromental distance, although it's very weak, it's present in every study. When it is less than 6, it means difficult intubation and receding mandible. Then the sternomental distance, it's an indication of neck flexion instead of radiological, subjecting the patient to radiological problems. Full extension will agree with the sniffing position, which is the best position for airway, for endotracheal intubation. Now, a very important test is the interincisor gap, which is limited mouth opening with difficult intubation. This is summarizing the tests, which is all depend on quantitative. Also the neck extension, more than 90 means that you will have an easy intubation. These are very simple tests. They will take only a few minutes of your time. The upper lip bite test overcome the quantitative test into a quality, which is less inter-observer variations. It's very good, and it's in correlation with Cormac and Lehan. Even the obesity, sometimes you intubate an obese patient very easily, sometimes not. So it's not confirmed yet which size or which kilograms or which BMI would be considered difficult. They also searching in mnemonics, bones for bag mask ventilation, a beard, an obese patient, no teeth, elderly, he has sleep apnea, he has snoring. Another LMA problem, restricted mouth opening, we cannot do it, obstruction, distorted airway, cannot be seated. Stiff lung, you should not put an LMA because a bronchospasm or reduced lung compliance the patient will not be ventilated properly with an LMA. The lemon, it's look externally on the patient's face, on his teeth, evaluate 3 distances, and then malympathy score and obstruction and neck mobility, which is very important. Then for a surgical airway, we have surgery, hematoma, obesity, tumor, radiation at the site, and we have obesity. Now, did we have a prediction of the airway? The Royal College of Anesthesia recently published a compendium, يعني الخلاصة. نعمل إيه based on expert opinion and 35 studies meta-analysis. So they recommended the combination of melampathy, thyromental distance, and history, the least airway assessment in every patient. Is it over? Not yet. Single tests, they do not properly assess the airway. So they tried to make combination of tests. Many risk indices. We have the Nagib, استخدم four variables. Then we have Wilson. He has five variables. Then we have Alainy. He have five values. Then we have the Ganzouri. We are all aware of the Ganzouri only because the guy, God bless him, is the one who opened the way for us in fiber optic intubation and ring a bell in airway assessment in our department. Yet it's not 100% proper. Then they did a lot of things. Airway difficulty score, intubation difficulty score, a lot of scores, none of them properly or accurately discriminated and easy from a difficult airway. Is it not still over yet? Not yet. Then we have new technologies. We have the ultrasound, which we hope it's going to be a routine in our practice. It's used for both the anatomy of the airway, the anatomy of the neck and airway, including the vocal cords. It's very important in cricothyroidotomy because it identifies the membrane. It's very important in percutaneous approach for cricothyrotomy. Confirm the endotracheal tube position for critically ill patients. Have a strong correlation with MRI for subglottic airway diameter, so it determines the endotracheal tube size, even the double lumen. And it also identifies in obese patients that it was faster than endotracheal intubation, faster than capnography and auscultation. أنا بصراحة مش عارفة إزاي، لكن يعني الفرق إن أنا أحط التيوب على الكابنوغرافي أو إن أنا أحط this means that you are going to be very skilled in ultrasonography. It's also in this is the only test that has specificity and sensitivity almost near the 100%. This is the only one, and we hope we do practice it more. The nasopharyngeal endoscopy, it's routinely used in our ENT departments by the otolaryngologist, but for the surgical purposes. But in anesthesia, it is underutilized. It's going to be very effective in discriminating preoperative airway difficulty or easy by examining the upper airway. So either sacrificing putting the patient to a weak fiber optic or discovering a difficult airway that was not expected. Now we are in our airway dilemma. Since we cannot rely on a preoperative airway assessment to accurately predict the difficult airway, we need to be equipped to manage the unexpected difficult or failed airway. The possibility of failed airway is a failed airway is rare, as we said, so it should be early and accepted and management appropriately. Since the incidence is low, the exposure is low, and the training is low, and the experience is low. To surpass إن نحن نتخطى the ever-present life-threatening risk of difficult airway, many guidelines have been issued. French, Canadian, American, Italian, everyone. Now, unfortunately, they do not serve to be useful for emergency. Okay, for emergency, flowchart of the European or American Heart Association were issued, but still we have no conclusive tests. The search for a predictive airway test, that has the ease of applicability, reliability, and accuracy of prediction continues. The investigators at present are at crossroads to which predictors should we pursue in the future. Studies since clinical anatomical predictors so far failed. كل اللي احنا بنعمله ده anatomical predictors failed to predict our airway. Now we come to the slogan of the مؤتمر كله, evidence-based airway. Is there an evidence-based airway? Yes, there is. Evidence-based airway is a collection of research evidence with clinical experience and then adding the patient's peculiar value and circumstances. Does it really matter in airway? Yes, it's undeniable. But the empirical evidence is itself not sufficient to provide optimal clinical care. A clear gap. Does the gap exist? Yes, it exists, and it's very clear between the empirical evidence and the clinical practice. Empirical evidence cannot be directly applied to individual patients, as the knowledge gained from clinical research does not directly answer the primary clinical question of what is best for our patient, this patient on the table. So we come to the conclusion, with the availability of advanced airway management devices and algorithms, airway assessment for difficult laryngoscopy and intubation may be considered less important by some clinicians. Inability of any airway assessment test to provide absolute prediction of difficulty further decreases the importance of airway evaluation. However, airway assessment is valuable as it helps the airway practitioner to develop the mindset, انت داخل على العيان وانت prepared, وانت في المود, وانت في الحالة زي ما بيقولوا, the mindset of anticipating difficulties and planning appropriately. Now, a word of wisdom. Assessing the airway, whether with a stepwise approach or with a gut feeling. Sometimes you see the patient without any assessment, هو داخل كده and says, oh my God, God help me. This is going to be difficult. So a process or a dynamic process will begin and will continue until you turn your patient is over from care. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.